If you look at the title of my talk, this might directly contradict the previous talk, because I want to say that quantum mechanics can emerge from a nonlinear theory. Now, indeed, what I'm going to talk about is not contradicting the previous talk, because there are certain nonlinear differential equations for which also a superposition principle exists. For instance, the so-called Riccati equation. And so I will concentrate on a complex version of the Riccati equation and will discuss this in detail using the example of the time-dependent Schrödinger equation. After this, I will show that you find the same structures also in time-independent quantum mechanics. You can include dissipation, and you can also link this to other fields of physics like nonlinear dynamics, thermodynamics, and so on. So the question is, why going from a simpler theory like a linear one to a more complicated nonlinear one? The reason is this nonlinear equation can still be linearized, so you can get something like the superposition principle, but in the nonlinear form, you can gain additional information that you do not find in the linearized version. And you can also find a form that can be compared to other fields of physics like thermodynamics or cosmology, which you cannot easily see in the linearized form. So as we heard yesterday, in the beginning of the 20th century, quantum mechanics was developed and is now one of the most successful theories in physics ever. But towards the end of the 20th century, there was another theory found that still is also very influential, and this is nonlinear dynamics. This is in agreement with phenomena that are observed in nature, like the dynamics of weather, growth processes in biological systems. And these processes can also have a direction of time. They can have dissipation of energy. And in these systems, the absolute size of the system usually doesn't matter, only the relative size. And all of you know these things of Mandelbrot sets, fractals, and so on. You all have seen these pictures, and you know that if you look at it, you see the same structures on different scales, but you also see that there are typical spiral forms that always occur, which are not only aesthetical to look at, but they also occur in biological systems and other systems in nature. So for instance, if you look at this nautilus shell or at this horn of this ram, you see there is an angular component and there is a radial component. And the radial component allows you to define something like a direction of time, because you can say the point that has the largest radius here is the oldest one because it was first growing out of here, or here the point who has the smallest radius is the tip of this horn who was also first coming out of the head of this animal. So we have a combination of a radial and an angular motion, and if you look at quantum mechanics, dynamics is only described by unitary transformation. You only have rotations, no change of the angle. And I will show you that in the formulation of quantum mechanics I will give you, you will also have some radial components that are quite important. So as I said, So at the beginning of this century, we are in a kind of schizophrenic situation. Quantum mechanics is reversible, conservative, and linear. But the observable macroscopic world, like it can be described by nonlinear dynamics, usually is irreversible, dissipative, and nonlinear, and also thermodynamics and cosmology cannot be easily integrated without problems into the formalism of quantum mechanics. So in order to link these two, we have to sacrifice one aspect of quantum mechanics, and I claim what we have to sacrifice is the credo of linearity, and we can still have something like the superposition principle if you look at certain nonlinear differential equations like the Riccati equations. So I will show you that something like a complex Riccati equation exists in time-dependent quantum mechanics, in time-independent quantum mechanics, and it can be extended to also include aspects like irreversibility and dissipation, and it can also be formally linked to other parts of physics like thermodynamics and cosmology. So let me start with a more detailed discussion of the Riccati equation in the terms of time-dependent Schrödinger equation. So if I look at the time-dependent Schrödinger equation for cases where we have exactly solvable solutions in terms of Gaussian wave packets, so for all kinds of quadratic Hamiltonians, we can describe these Gaussian wave packets by two parameters. One is the maximum, and one is the width of this wave packet. Both of these parameters can be time-dependent, and they can evolve in time, so this wave packet can move with the maximum, and at the same time, the width can spread. Now, to describe analytically this time behavior, we just make an ansatz of a Gaussian wave packet in this form. So the maximum is at this position, which I called eta, which is the classical position or the classical trajectory. And if we insert this into the Schrödinger equation, we obtain that this trajectory follows just the classical equation of motion like Newton's equation. But the coefficient of the quadratic term, this one is related to the mean square deviation in position or to the width of the wave packet. And this also has the dynamic equation. And this is now our complex Riccati equation. And now we will discuss what we can do with this equation. This is a first order differential equation. It's nonlinear because of this quadratic term, and it's inhomogeneous because of this term, and this omega can also be time dependent or time independent. It doesn't change the story. So let us look now at some closer on this Riccati equation. So we can solve this directly by finding a particular solution, for instance, like a constant, and then the general solution is the sum of this particular solution and another term that fulfills a similar equation, but now a homogeneous. So we eliminate the inhomogeneity, we gain a linear term, but now this is still a quadratically nonlinear first order differential equation, and this can be solved straightforwardly. We can linearize it, and the solutions can be written in terms of the particular solution plus the logarithmic time derivative of some integral that can be written explicitly, and in particular for this solution be a constant, you can write it in this form. So the denominator is just the derivative of the numerator, and you see there is some term occurring here which is connected with the initial conditions, and this is something that is typical for nonlinear differential equations. They can be very sensitive to the initial conditions. So this is not just a constant, but it can have quite qualitative effects, and I will show you this when I compare this to something in time-independent Schrödinger equation, namely with supersymmetric quantum mechanics. So you will find this, you will find the same structure like this if you go to supersymmetric quantum mechanics, where we have this Hamiltonian that has a potential that fulfills, again, the Riccati equation. You have a first derivative, you have a quadratic term, and you have a plus and minus here, which gives you the two potentials for the two Hamiltonians in the supersymmetric Hamiltonian, and you can derive the potential from this so-called superpotential, and this fulfills the Riccati equation. And now, for the harmonic oscillator, you have this simple form, but this is just a particular solution. If you want to have the general solution, you also have to solve this Bernoulli equation, and you see now you have the same structure, but time is replaced by space, and you have the logarithmic derivative of something that also contains some parameter, like our initial condition, this kappa zero. And now I'll show you that this initial condition can have strong influence, because if you look at the general potential you get from the harmonic oscillator, including this term from the Bernoulli equation, you see all these differently shaped potentials, they differ only in the value of epsilon, and you see they have totally different shapes, but all have the same spectrum, namely the spectrum of the harmonic oscillator. So you see the influence of the initial conditions of these parameters can be quite strong. Now, there is something else you can do with a Riccati equation. So we can define a new variable, which is just the width of the wave packet, and is related to the imaginary part of our complex variable in this form. From this, you get the real part as the relative change of the width of the wave packet. And if you put both of this in the Riccati equation, you end up with this equation. So this looks like Newton's equation, but it has this additional nonlinear term. And this equation was first discussed by Yermakov in 1880, more than 45 years before quantum mechanics. And he could show if you eliminate this omega between these two equations, you obtain a dynamically invariant. And this is still invariant even if even if the frequency is time dependent. So in this case, the Hamiltonian would not be a constant of motion, but this invariant is still a constant. And you see it has two terms that are quadratic. You can also express this in terms of real and imaginary part of our Riccati variable, and you can reformulate this as as the product of two terms that allows you to factorize this, this type of quantity, and you can also show that this has the dimension of an action. Now, you know you can factorize the harmonic oscillator that has been done already by Schrödinger. You have the sum of two quadratic terms. You can write it as the product of two operators. And if you divide it by omega also, this Hamiltonian turns into an action that can be expressed in terms of the annihilation and creation operators. Now it can be shown that the term that is proportional to the position is just the imaginary part of our Riccati variable. And in this case, you get a wave packet that has a constant width. If we have a wave packet with a time-dependent width, then of course alpha changes in time. You have to include the real part, and you can rewrite it in terms of generalized annihilation and generalized creation operators that are now time-dependent. And this can be used to construct something like coherent states. In an ordinary formalism, you know that the coherent state is an eigenfunction of the annihilation operator with a complex eigenvalue. In our generalized case, we have the same, but now we get coherent states with time-dependent width, and we can show that this eigenvalue is related to the Siemiatkowski invariant in a unique way. Okay, and now the last thing we can do with this complex equation, we can linearize it. So we end up, if we introduce this logarithmic time derivative of this complex variable, you see this is just the Newton's equation, but now for a complex quantity. And one can show that the imaginary part is just up to a constant, the classical trajectory, and the real part is something related to the velocity. And so you can see what you can actually do. You can map the oscillatory motion to something that is a circular motion, but now a circular motion in the complex plane. And if you write it in polar coordinates, you can also show, if you insert this into the nonlinear equation, you get a mixing of the amplitude and of the phase due to this quadratic term, and this leads to a conservation law that connects the angular velocity with the radius. So you see here we have a change of the radius and a change of the angle, and they are not independent, they are connected via this conservation law that is looking like the conservation of angular momentum in a real two-dimensional plane, but here it's a complex plane. So you have conserved angular momentum in the complex plane, and you can calculate the value, and the value of this angular momentum is h bar over 2, something you know from spin. Okay, let me skip this. Now, the same formal structure you can also find in time-independent quantum mechanics. In this case, we go back to 1926 to Madelung's formulation, this hydrodynamic formulation using the polar representation of the wave function with an amplitude and a phase. And if you insert this into the Schrödinger equation, you get two real equations, a modified Hamilton-Jacobi equation with the unfortunately so-called quantum potential, which has nothing to do with the potential. And this is an equation for the phase. And you get an equation for the amplitude, which is the continuity equation, that contains also the phase. So you have a coupling of phase and amplitude. And if you look at the time-independent situation, then this term disappears, and this time derivative is just the negative energy of the system. And from there, you get from the continuity equation to this conservation law. And of course, this can be fulfilled if r a squared, which is the square root of the density, is, or a squared times the gradient of s is a constant. That means you have the same structure that the derivative of the phase is 1 over the amplitude squared. And then from the Hamilton-Jacobi equation, you get something like this. And if you would insert 1 over a squared for gradient s, you get 1 over a to the third. You get, again, a kind of Yermakov equation. And to show you the similarities, so in the time-dependent case, we had this angular momentum conservation with the time derivative of the angle. Here we have the space derivative of the phase, which is proportional to 1 over the amplitude squared. In this case, this was the complex variable fulfilling the linearized Newton's equation. Here, the complex quantity is just the time-independent wave function fulfilling the linear Schrödinger equation of the time-independent Schrödinger equation, and both can be reformulated in terms of this quadratically nonlinear Riccati equations, and from this nonlinear term, you get the information that couples the two contributions, the phase and the amplitude, and this information you would not get if you just go back to the linearized form, because here, if you have real and imaginary part, you get two separate equally structured equations, but you get no connection between phase and amplitude or between real and imaginary parts. So this is additional information you can only get from this nonlinear version. Now, I said you can also include dissipation. There are many different ways to try to include dissipation and irreversibility already in the classical mechanics. And the problem is that Lagrangian and Hamiltonian formalisms in their normal structure do not include this phenomena. So you have to write down something like a Langevin equation with a friction term proportion to velocity, or you have to change the probability density by adding some kind of time reversal breaking diffusion term. And there are many attempts in the literature to try to modify the Schrödinger equation in order to include these aspects. I don't want to go into the details. I only want to tell you some of them can be even related by unitary or non-unitary transformations, but there are forms that seem to be physically sound, and they also give you, for quadratic Hamiltonians, solutions in the form of Gaussian wave packets, and I will show you the modification of the equations for the maximum and the width of these wave packets if you include the dissipation. So in this case, the maximum of the wave packet follows, again, a classical trajectory, but this includes now a linear velocity-dependent frictional force, like in the Langevin equation, and the change in the Riccati equation is just an additional linear term here proportional to the friction coefficient, but this is not a problem, because if we eliminate the inhomogeneity, we end up with the Bernoulli equation that has a linear term already, so the solution is straightforwardly exactly the same way like in the case without the dissipation, and you see you get from the Riccati equation, this Yermakov equation, and you also get an invariant, a dynamically invariant for a non-conservative system that you can also use to construct the corresponding creation and annihilation operators and the coherent states, including the dissipation. Let me skip this. So now, let me in the end come to some examples where we can link this structure that we have seen to other fields of physics. So for instance, if you look at this system of equations from nonlinear dynamics that describes the dynamic of a two-dimensional system, you can rewrite it in terms of polar coordinates, and you see now it's a cubic nonlinear system. But you can see from the structure of the solution, which is exactly like the one that we found from our Riccati equation in the case of a constant particular solution, that this can also be rewritten as a kind of Riccati or Bernoulli equation, where you have first derivative and quadratic term. And the point why I'm going to mention this here is that actually this coefficient of the linear term, which is nothing like the particular solution of the Riccati equation, this determines a kind of phase transition, because depending on whether this is positive or negative, your system approaches a fixed point or a limit cycle. So you have something like Hopf bifurcation in this system. And a similar property you can also get from the quantum system, including the dissipation. So you get splitting of levels due to the interaction with the environment, which you do not get otherwise. Now let's go now to a totally different field. Let's go to statistical thermodynamics. So to remind you, this was the solution of our complex Riccati equation in terms of the particular solution and of the solution of the Bernoulli equation. Now you see here again our initial condition plays the important role. If I assume that this is equal to zero, you can rewrite it in this form that can be reshuffled to gain something like a hyperbolic cotangence. And now we change our variables. We change time into inverse temperature and this particular solution into the ground state energy of the oscillator, and what you obtain is this. And this is just the average energy of a single oscillator in thermal equilibrium. And you can also reformulate this in terms of a logarithmic derivative by introducing the partition function, and you see this is nothing like the expression you are known from statistical mechanics. And we can do something else. Now we know a solution, but we know the relation to the Riccati equation, so we can try to construct the corresponding Riccati equation. So we start from the solution. We have the ground state energy of the oscillator, and we have this part. This is this Planck distribution, which is a Bose-Einstein distribution. Now we change the time derivative into the derivative with respect to 1/time, temperature, and then we obtain this type of Riccati equation. And now we can show that the inverse of this variable also fulfills the Riccati equation, but now with a different sign. And if you remember, when I made the comparison with supersymmetry, you had also a derivative with a plus and minus corresponding to the fermionic and the bosonic part. Now here we have a Bose-Einstein contribution for this. Now we go to the inverse variable, we have the negative sign, and now we can write down the solution, and what we obtain is the ground state minus a Fermi-Dirac distribution. So we see this relation between fermion and boson is also represented here in the relation between these two different Riccati equations. How much longer do I have? Okay, so then I can also discuss the next example. So if you look at the Bose-Einstein condensate, this can be described by a Gross-Peterjewski equation, which is a nonlinear Schrödinger equation, a cubic nonlinear Schrödinger equation. And this condensate is usually trapped in a device that has a time-dependent fields, electric and magnetic fields, that can be expressed in terms of an oscillator with a time-dependent frequency. Now, in general, it's not possible to solve this equation analytically, but you can still describe the dynamics of these condensates in terms of so-called moments. And these are defined in the following way. You have something that is related to the width of the wave packet, something that is related to the radial momentum, and something that is related to the energy. And these three moments, this first is just the normalization, these three are dynamical variables, and they fulfill a closed set of linear differential equations. Now, if you replace this second moment by, you can rephrase this all in terms of the second moment, so you get a second derivative and a nonlinear term, and now if you replace the square root of the second moment by this variable x, you again get our Amakov equation, which is nothing but a reformulation of the complex Riccati equation, and you can link this to the dynamics of the position uncertainty, momentum uncertainty, and position-momentum uncertainty correlations. And now the last example is cosmology. If we take Einstein's field equations and apply the cosmological principle of spatially homogeneous and isotropic universe, we can use the Robertson-Walker matrix. So this is the scale factor, more or less the radius of the universe, and k gives you the curvature of the universe. From this, you can write down the Friedmann-Lemaître equations, where h is the Hubble parameter, and this is the energy density. And now what I can do, I can assume that the matter source is a self-interacting scalar field, so I can express the energy density and the pressure in terms of this field. I can take this, insert it here, take the time derivative, and put this in the time derivative of this equation. And what I obtain is, first of all, this term. And now I introduce a new time variable, so-called conformal time, and what you see is, again, our Yermakov equation. Second derivative, something like an oscillator frequency squared, linear term, and 1 over the cubic term. So if we know this, we know this is equivalent to a complex Riccati equation. If we know the Riccati equation, we can use this complex variable to write down the corresponding creation and annihilation operator. Once we have the annihilation operator, we can write down the coherent state of the universe, so to say, for this particular model. So I just wanted to give you an impression that what we have done here is we tried to find a nonlinear version of quantum mechanics that can incorporate phenomena that we know from observation of nature, like directions of time and irreversibility and dissipation, that this nonlinear version is still compatible with the superposition principle because the Riccati equation can be linearized. We have seen that using the example of the time-dependent Schrödinger equation, we can do different things with the Riccati equation. We can solve it directly and compare this with supersymmetry. We can find this Yermakov form that allows us to find a dynamically invariant. And we can linearize it to a kind of complex version of Newton's equation that gives us the same information like the time-dependent Schrödinger equation. We can use the same form for time-independent Schrödinger equation, now not only for the harmonic oscillator, but for any potential, because the time-dependent frequency is just replaced by the space-dependent potential. We can show that dissipative version of this exists and that the form of this Riccati equation can also be found in nonlinear dynamics, in thermodynamics, Bose-Einstein condensates, cosmology. I could add optics, I could add quantum optics, electrodynamics. I could even add number theory because you can show that the Yermakov equation is also able to describe the distribution of prime numbers in mathematics. And last but not least, one can even show that all of this Riccati business in the complex space can be related to the old question of Pythagoras, how to find Pythagorean triples. You know, this is the question, if you have right-angled triangles, you look for the ones where the sides have integers, so like 3, 4, and 5. 9 plus 4 is 16. But if you look for a second example, I think most of you would have difficulties to give me one if they don't know the solution. One other is 5, 12, and 13 or so, but you can get all of them if you know complex Riccati equations. So any kind of quantization problem can be traced back to Pythagoras and to Riccati. And if you want to know more details about this, you can ask me in the coffee break, and I thank you for your attention.